Hello.
This is just a random catch-up video. I have three things that I want to talk about. Pens and journaling, typewriter, and a doll. So we'll start off with pens. I just wanted to share one of the best fountain pen accessories I think one could have. As a fountain pen user, if there's one accessory you get, I feel like this should be at least in your top three. And that is a traveling inkwell. So there are two on the market that I'm aware of. This one is the Typewriter, which is the cheaper option. I got this off of Goulet Pens. And not only is it amazing to have ink when you're out and about, because some pens, it's really hard to know where you are at your ink levels. Like this one is opaque and the ink is in a rubber sack. I have no way of knowing other than I know about how many pages I can write with it. And I also know when the ink is, when the pen starts to write a little bit dry, I know like, oh, it's gonna run out of ink soon. But other than that, I don't have a way of knowing when I leave the house. And just today, actually, I was at a coffee shop and I was doing some writing and I was getting a little low on ink and my pen was writing very dry. So I was able to refill it. The great thing about this particular model, or the two traveling inkwells that are available, is that they are designed so that you don't make any messes. You don't need a traveling cloth. You don't have to worry about spilling. Of course, you still have to be careful, but I just want to demonstrate how this works. So there's like a little cork and it accommodates most pens, which is really nice. I would test first to make sure your pen fits, because on the inside is a rubber gasket and it kind of seals it. So you drop your pen into the rubber gasket and then very daringly you flip it over like so and fill it however you need to fill it. So this one is a lever filler, ta-da. And the great thing about this is that there is no ink. Well, okay, just a little bit of ink, but very minimal amount of ink on the grip section, which is nice. So it just, I always take a traveling cloth anyways, because I like to clean off the nib afterwards. And also sometimes fountain pens leak and it's nice to be prepared. So anyways, it's just, that's a great little option. Highly recommend it. Anyways, I'm also using this old Hurlstone pen pouch. This is my favorite pen pouch of all time. I've had this one for years and it's the one I always go to. I like that. I love the fabrics, first of all, and it carries my fountain pen and an inkwell and then a little cleaning cloth in the back. I've also carried extra cartridges in the back pocket too in the past. It just depends on what I'm carrying. Also, real quick, in addendum to that little fountain pen, my journal, in the last video, I talked about how I put a leather wrapping around the insert and I didn't like that. So I ripped it off very carefully and recovered it. And I'm so much happier with how it turned out. So this is from an old Arizona's Highways magazine. I left the edge of the magazine, the paper, this is from the 1950s. It's really brittle. And so I just left the edge because I kind of liked the look of that. This is volume number 61. On the inside, I did more of the same. There was a little ink smear right here, so I put a sticker over it. And then in the back, I have more of the same picture. This is my Tumamoc record for September, so all the days that I've gone up Tumamoc, which so far, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 days out of the 23 days currently I've climbed Tumamoc, and that's kind of exciting. And then the very back, more of the same, all from the same Arizona Highways magazine. I had intended to have the Arizona Highways magazine written because this was a cover and it was written out on the cover, of course, with the date. And I accidentally glued it on upside down. So I remedied that with another sticker. And I'm really happy with how that turned out. I'm halfway through this journal now, this insert, which is the Galen Leather Tomoe River Paper insert. And it's just, I feel really inspired. It feels really cozy and homey and comforting and familiar and all the things that you want your best friend journal to feel like. So I'm really enjoying that. Next, I want to talk real quick about a doll that I got. So No Spend September was a bust. It didn't pan out that way. And I have a couple of things that I bought this month. This is a knockoff Blythe doll that I found on Etsy. She is has a flaw that's like hardly noticeable, and she was super, super cheap. And I really was drawn to her colors. I like her color theme. I think it's really pretty. So Blythe dolls are strange. They're these, if you have never seen one before, obviously she has a massive head and a relatively small body. That's part of their charm, or that's part of why some people might think they're horrific. They also have eye chips that are changeable. So yeah, you can put different colors. They're really customizable. And a lot of people, they'll like take this plastic and they'll carve into it with Dremel tools and knives and repaint them and reshape their faces so that they're a lot more detailed. They'll also change the color of the eyes. They'll also change the direction of the eyes. So right now her eyes are looking a little bit like downward maybe. And so a lot of people shift them up so they're looking more upward, which is one of the few customizations that I think I want to do with her. I actually really like everything about her other than the way her eyes are facing. So I probably won't change much right now, but I feel like she will make a great project doll in the future should I ever get inspired. But in the meantime, she's just kind of a fun, happy little thing to have around and to play dress up with. I want to do some sewing, and yeah, she'll just be this little desk buddy. You can also change the hair too if you want, but I like her hair a lot. I think it's super cute. This particular doll also came with a fake A-Zone Pure Nemo body. So Blythe dolls originally have very limited mobility bodies. This one is super, super poseable. It has joints and also lots of spare hands. So you have like little I love you hands. Let's see if it'll, there we go. There's like little salute hands and peace sign hands and waving hands and hands that could be used to hold onto objects. So it's just, they're really fun. And kind of like, you can enjoy them as they are or customize the heck out of them. And I think that's the beauty of the Blythe. So moving on, the last topic I just wanted to chat is I have a new typewriter. Oh my gosh. This is the ultimate traveling typewriter. I'm so excited. I travel a lot with my typewriters as is, and some of them are rather big and heavy, and so I'm always looking for that perfect travel typewriter. The problem with a lot of the smaller typewriters is, in my experience at least, the quality is a little bit different because they're trying to minimize as much as they can to make it for a smaller package, and so some of the materials feel less durable and are plastic instead of metal. Some of the keys are missing. Like often there isn't an exclamation point because they're trying to condense everything down. This, I feel like, is a beautiful balance between a really great quality typing experience with a very small package. So without further ado, look at how skinny this thing is. This is an Olympia SF travel typewriter. It's so minimal that the case is just a lid. This is actually the bottom of the typewriter here. It's still a heavy machine, which I like. I find it very disconcerting when typewriters are lightweight, to be honest. I'm like, how long is this gonna last? Because I associate the heft with like the tank-like construction that's never gonna break. I got this off Jot and Tittle Typewriters. I'll post a link down below to her shop. I highly recommend her shop. This is the second typewriter I've purchased from her. She's a trustworthy person. She posts every single typewriter on her YouTube channel that she lists for sale, so you can get a sense of how it functions, how it looks, how it sounds. They don't do restoration, but they do select typewriters that are in really good condition. They put new ribbons in, they clean them up. Maybe if there is like a bigger problem, they'll attend to that, or they'll talk about it in their listing. So generally their typewriters are a little less expensive than a lot of other shops that do the restoration work, but they make sure that the typewriter is functioning, which is really important. This one came with its original manual. This is from 1956. I don't know if I said that already, but without further ado, let's just take a look at the machine. It's so pretty. So I don't know if this is the color that it always has been. It's quite possible that this was a white machine or something that just yellowed with age, but I love the creamy yellow color. It also has the burgundy keys, and these keys are really solid. Olympia makes really solid machines, so I'm just very grateful. I love the design of how like compact everything gets. So we have this little paper holder in the back. This flips up and down so that you can, when you put the lid on it, it doesn't get in the way. Brilliant. This is what moves the carriage, by the way. It's on carriage lock right now. It has a really nice bell sound. Let's see if I can engage it for you. It's really hard to do this, like, I was not a very good, here, give me one sec. It's just a nice loud bell. It has little margin guides here. It's just, such a nice machine. I might talk about it more in the future, but I just wanted to really quickly share it because it's just so nice. So nice. It's funny, the carriage release is in a different position than the Adler that I've been using most frequently, so I keep going to the wrong button. But anyways, burgundy and yellow. So pretty, such a pretty combination. It even has, like, on the carriage, these little burgundy knobs. Ah, it's gorgeous. The handle kind of matches the keys. It's great. I really like this machine. I also want to just show you, I already typed up. I know it feels silly to, like, not show you how the machine types right now, but this is just a casual video. I'm trying not to complicate things. I just wanted to do a couple of quick updates. Let's see. Where is that piece of paper? Oops. I guess. I don't know where it went. But it types really nice. One day I'll do like a proper introduction video for that typewriter. And also a collection video for my typewriters if anybody would be interested in seeing that. So that's it. Those are the exciting additions from this botched no spend September, but I'm not upset about it. Laura from Jot and Tittle Typewriters, by the way, she posts new typewriters every Saturday. And so it's just like a habit of mine to look regularly to see if she has any machines that kind of strike my fancy. And this one did, so I felt like it was, I don't know, important. And this one, this Blythe doll was so cheap that I was like, why not? I've been wanting to get a Blythe doll again for a while now. but not wanting to spend the money because they can be a little pricey. So anyways, thank you all for watching. Bye.